In this section, we are going to talk about failsafe. It is an equally important topic to be discussed and understand deeply, just like time travel. We have already seen this continuous data protection lifecycle in the time travel section. Let's revisit this diagram. We already seen that we can perform various DDL, DML operations on the current data storage on Snowflake, which means we can create various types of objects such as database, schema, tables, and views. As per the type of the table, it has respective time travel. For permanent tables, we have the retention period up to 90 days. But for transient and temporary tables, we just have up to 1 day. But the minimum time travel period is 0 days. We have already seen how to alter the values of the data retention time period in the previous section. Now, once the data has completed their time travel retention period, the data will be moved into failsafe zone. In failsafe zone, for transient tables, failsafe zone is not applicable. That means the failsafe zone exists for 0 days. But for permanent tables, by default, it is for 7 days, and this cannot be altered. The important point to note here is there is no user operations allowed in the failsafe zone, and data can be only recoverable by Snowflake. Unlike time travel, where we can run various queries and can create clones of the table, and we can also travel in the time to take the data from the history as well. To elaborate about failsafe, it is basically a zone which is meant for usage of Snowflake only. User interactions are not allowed, and failsafe can be used by Snowflake in case of any hardware failures or in some disasters where their complete AZ, which means availability zones, or complete regions where their clusters or the group of computers have been set up, they got failed. In such scenarios, Snowflake can recover your data from this failsafe zone so that Snowflake can give you complete or high time availability with no downtime. Let's read about failsafe now. Failsafe ensures historical data is protected in the event of a system failure or any disaster. It provides a non-configurable 7-day period during which historical data is recoverable by Snowflake only. Again, user interactions are not allowed. You cannot perform any operations in the failsafe zone to maybe alter any property or any other operation that you are thinking of. Failsafe period starts immediately after the time travel retention period ends. We have already understood by this diagram. Failsafe zone is not provided as a means for accessing historical data after the time travel retention period has ended. As we have already seen that time travel can be used to fetch the data from the historical data as well, but failsafe is not meant for it. And this is because it is for use only by Snowflake to recover data that may have been lost or damaged due to extreme operational failures. Now let's again go to the timeline that we have already seen in the time travel section. While discussing time travel, we already saw this example where we were creating an employees table, which is a permanent table, in which we have inserted 3 records on day 1, and then on day 5 we inserted again 5 records, and on day 10 we updated 2 records. But now employees table have 12 days of time travel period, and after 12 days it will automatically move into failsafe zone. On day 12, time travel ends here for day 1 snapshot. What does it mean? It means that for any table like day 1, we created employees table, the time travel period was 12 days. So at 12th day, by the end of 12th day, the time travel period will end, and on 13th day, the data will be moved into failsafe zone. But the important point to understand here is all the data that was there on day 1, which means the snapshot of the data on day 1, will be moved to failsafe on day 13. But for snapshot on day 5, it will not be moved to the failsafe zone on day 13. It will be moved on the 13th day from day 5, which means on 18th day it will be moved into failsafe zone. Similarly, for day 10, the failsafe zone time period starts at day 23, and for any changes that we have done on day 12, the failsafe zone starts from day 25. Cost is an important aspect while working on Snowflake. It is important to understand how pricing is done for failsafe zone. Any objects that are there in failsafe zone have associated cost with them. For example, on day 1, we created employees table and inserted 3 records. It may be possible that on the day 1, we inserted these 3 records at 11 a.m. Then at 2 p.m., we again inserted 5 records. And at 8 p.m., we inserted 10 records. And at 11 p.m., we updated few of the records. So these are multiple transactions that have been completed on day 1. Now, let's suppose on day 1, your snapshot of the data was of 1 GB. Now, the first snapshot of day 1 was at 11 a.m. So that snapshot will be moved on 13th day, 11 a.m. to the failsafe zone. So Snowflake will keep starting your charges for the table for which you have created a snapshot at 11 a.m. on day 1. So this is the first snapshot that have been moved on 13th day into the failsafe zone. Then on day 1 itself, you also did some changes at 2 p.m. This is the second snapshot which will be moved into failsafe zone at 2 p.m. day 13. Similarly, other snapshots will also be moved to the failsafe zone on day 13 at respective times. Now, coming to the cost, we already know that at day 1, the table size was around 1 GB. For each snapshot, failsafe zone takes respective size of the data. Like if it has created 5 snapshots in a day for the same table, it will consider them as 5 GB of the data. So Snowflake will charge you as per 5 snapshots, which means 5 GB of the data storage. But actual data that you currently have is just 1 GB. So you end up paying more to Snowflake while working with failsafe zone. So I would recommend to perform design consideration very carefully while working on Snowflake. Also, as a recommendation, you should use transient tables instead of permanent tables during the testing phase or the development phase in Snowflake. This is because transient tables do not have any failsafe zone, and this can really save your cost during the development. Now let's see why we should use failsafe over the backup. Data corruption or loss can happen with any database management system. Traditionally, DBS used to create the backups of the database objects such as database, schemas, and the tables multiple times so that if any disaster occurs, they can restore their data with ease. However, there were some challenges that they need to tackle. So to mitigate the risk, DB used to perform full and incremental backups, but this can double or even triple overall data storage. Data recovery can be painful and costly due to various factors. Let's see what factors are there due to which cost can be very high. First of all, time required to reload the data was very huge, because if you have multiple backups of maybe database can be very huge, like it can go up to 1 terabyte and over. So to recover 1 terabyte of data in the traditional systems and this backup approach can be very time consuming as well as costly approach. This is also possible that once you are performing the recovery of the data, all the operations will be down during that time. It is also possible that during recovery, there is loss of the data since the last backup. Now, in Snowflake, failsafe provides an efficient and cost-effective alternative to backup that eliminates the remaining risk and scales with your data. In the next lecture, let's see how Failsafe consumes the data storage on Snowflake.